Let's pray together. Let's pray. In Christ's name, amen. I want you to be honest after the first 10 seconds. Did you open your eyes? Did you look up here to see maybe Professor Hamm had fainted or had a heart attack, or he was actually speaking but the microphone wasn't working? Or maybe not. Maybe you actually used that time to commune with God. I want to talk about prayer today. But more than talk about it, I want us to do it together here today. But I want us to practice a form of prayer that may be new, or strange, or even uncomfortable to you. I want to talk about prayer as silence, as praying without saying anything. This form of prayer is called contemplation. Let's see. There. And it has a rich history in the Christian faith. But it is a discipline that is almost unheard of. And I use that word intentionally, unheard of, because silence is not an experience we usually have during most of our waking hours these days. And I know that contemplation, praying without saying, is not doing anything. My title was Doing Nothing in the Presence of God. Contemplation is doing something. It is listening without speaking or thinking or doing. And it's hard work. I confess to you that I'm not good at praying this way, but I want to get better at it. I believe that there is much that God wants to share with us. And to hear God, we have to learn how to pray in new ways. And one of those ways is contemplation. There were two scriptures today. One was from there are two scriptures today, one from Luke and one from Matthew. And both of them are places where we find the Lord's Prayer. You know this prayer. It's one of the main prayers that Christians use daily, use weekly. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. If you are a Christian, you no doubt know this prayer and have said it often. You probably learned it as a child, maybe from your family or from church teachers. And it's a wonderful prayer. I say it every morning at the end of my quiet time. It's good to say it often. The disciples come to Jesus and they ask him, Lord, teach us to pray. Now, isn't that interesting? These are men who probably have grown up praying at least twice a day in the Jewish tradition, morning and evening. They knew prayers. They knew how to say prayers, but yet they come to Jesus and they ask Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray. And Jesus responds very appropriately. He gives them a prayer to say. He says, when you pray, say this, Our Father. Jesus responds to the disciples' request to teach them to pray by giving them a prayer. It is as if the question the disciples are asking is, Lord, teach us what to pray. In learning to pray, our first prayers are prayers that we have learned from others. We learn how to pray by imitating the words of others, by repeating the words that we have learned. You know prayers, probably remember prayers from childhood. I know I do. I still remember childhood prayers at meals. God is great. God is good. Let us thank God for our food. By God's hands we all are fed. Thank you, God, for daily bread. You know that one. Lord Jesus, be our holy guest, our morning joy, our evening rest. And with our daily bread impart your love and peace to every heart. Those are prayers from my childhood. I learned them very early on, and I'm Harabuji, so that was a long time ago when I was a kid. But I still cherish them. They're still important to me because there were people who I loved who taught them to me. You probably have heard the other one, too, the one that we say at night before we go to bed. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. Now, any self-respecting child, when they get to the next line, probably paused and maybe were a little bit scared to say this line. I'm not sure why it's part of this children's prayer right before they go into the dark to sleep by themselves. But the line is, if I should die before I wake. I pray the Lord my soul to take. I learned that prayer, but as an adult, I learned another version of it. Guide me safely through the night. And wake me with the morning light. That one's nicer to me. I remember these prayers, and I'm glad I remember them. They're important to me. They're part of my history of faith. So learning how to pray means learning what to pray, what words to say. But what if, in addition to the disciples asking Jesus what to pray, what if the disciples were also asking Jesus, Lord, teach us how to pray? What if the question includes not just the words to say, but how to pray, the times, the places, the postures, the attitudes? Teach us, Lord, the practice of praying. And so this is why I've included Matthew passage in today's scripture reading. For in Matthew, Jesus initiates the lesson on prayer by saying, and when you pray. Jesus does get eventually to the what of the prayer, to the prayer itself. He does teach him that Lord's Prayer. But what does he do first? He teaches them how to pray. He gives them some things to try and to practice when they are praying in addition to the words of the prayer. When you pray, go into your room and close the door. Pray to your Father who is unseen. Do not keep babbling like pagans, who think their many words are what God wants to hear. Don't be like them, Jesus says. Jesus teaches them not only what to pray, but how to pray. For a rich and varied prayer life, to become stronger prayer warriors, we need both kinds of prayer. We need to know the words to say, and we also need to know different ways to pray. Jesus teaches us both. Now I'm going to ask this next question. Do you know how many years of theological education I've had? This is not to brag. In fact, it's a little bit embarrassing. Normally, PhD is normally 4 years. So just give me a number, okay? What do you think? Oh, lower. Seven. Eight.
10. 12.
I have had 13 years of theological education. Now, I said, I'm not saying this to impress you. I'm saying that because in those 13 years, I have never had one course on prayer. Not one. I was never in a course that taught me prayers. I was never in a course that taught me how to pray. I think it was assumed, certainly it was by me, and perhaps by the institutions where I did my education, that we were future moksanims. We were future teachers, and we already knew how to pray. We didn't need a course on prayer. And it's probably true, we thought that ourselves. We're religious professionals. Of course we know how to pray. God is great and God is good. Now I lay me down to sleep. I know how to pray. When you pray, you open your mouth and you say, "Our Father who art in heaven." I had learned to say the words, but I knew very little about how to pray. Thankfully, there was a major crisis in my life, a very dark time in my life. I left ministry for almost 20 years. I despaired. Pastor Greg was, before we started, praying about those people who may be on the edge of despair. I was there. I questioned my existence. I questioned my calling. And what I discovered was those resources, those prayers that I had learned as a child were not enough. And fortunately, there were some people who rescued me and taught me again how to pray. It was not only the words to say, but it was also the practice, how to pray. I learned how to pray again. I learned how to pray a type of prayer which is part of the Christian tradition, but has often been forgotten and lost. It's not Buddhist transcendental meditation. It's not mandala creation. It is a Christian practices which have been part of our faith for centuries, but have often been forgotten and therefore untaught and unlearned. One of those disciplines I learned is called Lectio Divina, or the practice of holy reading. It is a four-step process. First, you read scripture, Lectio. Then you meditate on that scripture. You try to find a word or a phrase or a verse that somehow speaks to your heart, that somehow captures your attention. And then the third step is praying, oratio. You simply lift up that word, that phrase, and your concerns to God. You pray your heart, what you need, what you want. You praise your praises, your thanksgivings, your confessions. And finally, the fourth step is contemplation, contemplatio. And it is a time when you listen to God, where you try to hear what God might be saying to you during this prayer time. I've been doing this spiritual discipline for over 25 years. That's longer than some of you have been alive. Again, I'm not bragging. For me, it is life. It represents my salvation. It brought me back. This discipline of Lectio Divina brought me back from that edge of despair. And it doesn't work for everybody, but for me, it was a powerful lesson of how God can use a practice to call me back to Him. It saved my life. Of course, there have been months when I stopped doing it, but I always, always come back to it because it gives me life. It gives me assurance. It gives my life meaning and purpose. It gives me peace. It gives me confidence. Not that it prevents bad things from happening to me. It doesn't. It simply prepares me for the day. It simply prepares me for whatever happens to me during the day. So don't think I'm an arrogant guy by sharing that with you. I'm sharing something that redeemed my life from the pit. It's a form of prayer called contemplation. And I don't do it very often. It's very hard for me to do. Usually I get up early in the morning. I'll tell you, I'm an expert on the first three steps. Boy, I got that reading down. Meditation, yes sir, I got my journal there and I write a verse or a word that touches my heart and then I pray. And you should see my prayer list. Impressive, 2 pages front and back. You're on there. Some of you are on there by name. Others are on their Carmichael College. My team name are on that prayer list. Students, EC, EGC, my church history class, president, Han Dongde, other people. They're on that list. And it takes me a while to get through that list. And by the time I get through that list, I'm tired. I'm hungry. My stomach. I'm beginning to think about what's coming today and what I need to do, and I need to get dressed and go to work and start the day. And so it's hard for me to stop and to listen, to spend some time in silence to try to hear what God might be wanting to say to me. I think it's important. And I want to try to work on it. And maybe by today, we can encourage each other to work on this kind of prayer. John Calvin said that prayer is an intimate conversation with God. Now, a conversation means a two-way street, right? We talk with others, and we listen when they speak to us. That's what dialogue means, right? Dia meaning two. I talk, you listen. You talk, I listen. Think about your friendships. Do you count people as your close friends who are always talking? Do you feel close to people who always want you to listen to them, but they don't have time to listen to you? How do you feel when you have something important or great to share with your friends, but they're too busy to listen to you. Have you ever wanted a friend just to listen to your problem or to your heart's deepest desire? To listen not in order to fix it or to judge it or to treat it as unimportant, but just to hear it, just to accept it. And by accepting your words, they accept you. Contemplation is the discipline of listening to God's part of the conversation. How do we do that? Well, I think we first have to shut up. We have to stop talking. We can only hear if we stop talking and start listening. One person has tried to describe contemplation as like being in the presence of someone whom you deeply love. No one has ever been in love, who has ever been in love needs to be reminded that there are moments in loving relationships when words are unnecessary. It is the same in our relationship with God. Wordless, quiet rest in the presence of the one who loves us has a name in the Christian tradition, and it's called contemplation. Once again, we practice silence, letting go of our own words, this time enjoying the experience of simply being in God's presence. You know, I still have memories of my childhood. When I would wake up in the morning, my dad woke up very early and would eat his breakfast. And I can remember being a child of 3 or 4, and I would go into the kitchen and I would crawl into his lap. And I would eat his breakfast. The breakfast that my mom had cooked for him, I ate his breakfast. But I imagined this resting in the presence of God kind of like that image of me in my father's lap. I'm surrounded by him. I'm not saying anything necessarily, but I'm loved. I feel secure and safe. I'm being fed. Literally, I'm being fed his breakfast. Maybe that's something of what it means to rest in God's presence. Not only do we stop talking, but we try to stop thinking as well. We try to let go of our thoughts, our schedules, our agendas, our worries, our plans, our handphones, and simply try to rest. Some have described it as emptying ourselves completely in order to make room for God to enter in. It's not easy. Don't fool yourself. If you haven't tried it, or maybe if you have, you know it's not easy to do. That's why it's called a practice. We keep working at it. We never master it, but we keep working at it. In my church history class, we study the church fathers and mothers of the desert. And sometimes my students think, when they read the words of the Abbas and Ammas of the desert, they said, oh, they had it easy. Anybody can concentrate in the desert. There's no distractions. It'd be simple to focus and contemplate God. But as they read their words, they realize that those fleeing to the desert could escape the temptations of the city, but not the thoughts and temptations of their own hearts. Abba Anthony said, "Whoever sits in solitude and is quiet has escaped 3 wars. Hearing, speaking, and seeing. Yet, against one thing shall he continually battle, that is his own heart." It's challenging enough to be constantly connected to the world. It's another challenge altogether to try and shut down our thoughts and simply rest in another's presence. How can we do that? How can we learn this practice? Well, I want us to try here and now. Now, as I told my team before chapel started, they were worried about falling asleep. And I said, don't worry about that. If you fall asleep, you probably need to sleep. So don't feel guilty about that. But I'm going to have you close your eyes, okay? I'm going to have you sit up, not slouch, okay? And if they're already asleep, don't wake them up.
Feet flat on the floor. Don't cross them. Flat on the floor. Hands on your knees in front of you. I teach palms up. Why? Because prayer is preparing you to receive a gift. You can't receive a gift like this. You can't receive a gift like this. You can receive a gift. Your hands are open. So I encourage you, sit up straight, don't slouch. That is your mother always. Don't slouch. Good posture. Feet on the foot. Hands up.
Now, if you're doing this by yourself, alone, I'm just giving you, I put some guidelines on the bulletin for today. Find a place where you can be by yourself, maybe where you won't be interrupted. Sometimes that's a challenge at Handong to find those kind of places, but I encourage you to look for that kind of place. And I'm going to ask you, this is another challenge I have for you today, turn off your phone. Now, I know some of you can't do that. It's incapable, and that's fine. So if you can't turn it off, I ask that you put it on vibrate or something like that, okay? This is a big distraction. You know when it goes, get down. You gotta look at it. I know, you just gotta look at it. It may be the president of Korea calling you and offering you a new job, okay? So for now, next 10 minutes or so, I ask you just turn it off. Turn off your computer, turn off music, TV, whatever. Sit comfortably. Now here's another part that I think we have to relearn, and that is breathing. I know how to breathe. I breathe all the time. I do it unconsciously, right? Right. You do. But I want to teach you another way to breathe, and that's breathe in with your nose, out with your mouth. I want you to bring, you know, we only use about 1/3 of our lung capacity, unless, of course, you're playing sports or something like that. But normally, we only use 1/3 of our lung capacity. So I want you to fill up your lungs. I want you to fill up. I want the air to go all the way down to your toes, to your fingernails, okay? So, out with the mouth. Get all that air that went down to your fingernails and your toes, get it out. People who've taught prayer say, imagine that the air going in, you know, air has a very theological name in Old Testament, it's ruach, which is spirit, which is wind, which is breath, right? Imagine that wind going into you, filling you up as Christ's presence, or imagine it as light. Bringing light to your whole body, inside and out. And when you exhale, imagine that you are exhaling all that darkness in you, all that stress, all those worries, all those decisions, all those things to do. Expel it. Get it out of your body. So you're exhaling it, and you're bringing in Christ's presence. And we haven't gotten to the hardest part yet. The hardest part is your mind. With those thoughts that pop into your brain, just as soon as you get calm, just as soon as you close your eyes, just as soon as you get relaxed, then they start attacking you. It's very common. They pop up. All those things. Oh, I forgot to do this. Oh, I needed to call this person back. Oh, I didn't do my assignment. Oh, I need to find out what the menu is for the cafeteria today. Oh, I got to do this. Oh, I didn't do that. They will pop up, I guarantee you, as soon as you're ready to pray. So my advice to you is that before you sit down, you just simply have a pad of paper and a pencil next to you. Not your phone. Piece of paper. So that when those things pop into your head, and they will, you simply write it down and go back. Go back to your practice. That way, you don't have to worry about forgetting it. You can come back to it later. One person who has taught prayer said, imagine you're sitting on a riverbank, and you're watching the river flow by. And that river, as it flows by, is carrying your thoughts, your schedules, your worries, your doubts. And when you see them, don't grab them. Don't pull them out of the river. Simply let them go. Let the current take them. So much of our prayer life is giving to God. Giving God our praise, giving God our confessions, giving God our requests, our victories, our sorrows, our shopping list request. And we can continue to do that. I'm not saying stop doing that. No. But adding on to that word prayer, our voiced prayers, we also add another part, just as important. We try to listen. We try to receive. Contemplation is the receiving part of prayer. So oftentimes we have our shopping list. God, I need this, and I need this, and will you do this and correct that? And if you could, by noon today, thank you very much. Okay, I've got to go to class now. And so much of it is what we want. And so this is a time where we stop and say, I'm here, Lord. I'm ready to listen to what you want. And God wants our prayers. God expects our prayers. Our prayers are a joy, not a burden to God. But God also wants us to listen. Remember, it's a conversation. God wants to talk to us as well. He has something to say to us. And we can hear God in lots of ways, through music, through scripture, through others, through dreams, and sometimes in silence. Try praying without saying. Try resting in God's presence. Try doing nothing, thinking nothing, saying nothing, and see what happens. Macarius was a desert father, and he said to the brothers in Skitus, which is a place in Egypt where they lived in community, he said to the brothers, brothers, flee. The brothers looked around him and said, we're already in the desert, okay? We've already left civilization. Where do you want us to flee? Macarius put his fingers on his lips, and he said, I tell you, you must flee this. Then he went into his cell, shut the door, and remained alone. Let's pray. Lord, help us to make silence our friend, not our enemy. Help us to crave it and to want it, to nourish it, to seek it, to find it, to use it in order to draw closer to you. May our silence be as powerful and as rewarding as our words. This we ask in the name of Him who spent numerous hours alone with you, Jesus Christ. Amen.